They say good fences make good neighbors. For you, my friend, this might be true, but you still gotta put boards on the window to the soul inside of you.
Issues of Spin, who profiled him when he turned 50. He actually had a lot to say about you during that time, or a bit to say about you from that time. So do you remember this age when he turned 50? Because you would have been like 8 or 9 at this point.
Right, when he turned 50 would have been, yeah, when my dad turned 50, he would have been, that would have been 1997, right? 1987, sorry. And yeah, I was about 8 years old. And I mean, I remember when we grew, when in that article he talks about how he was getting off drugs, and I was 5 years old, and you know, I held his hand, or kind of looped my arm around his while I colored, and he sat there for a really long time, and you know, his attention span was kind of shot because he was doing drugs stuff, but I wasn't ever aware of it. I think it weighed on him. He was worried that I was, but I wasn't. He was a great dad, and I wouldn't change anything about the way he raised me. You know, he was very kind. But being mentioned in the article is funny, because being here doing this, it is kind of a loop around, you know. It's cool.
You have won 2 Grammys in your career, which is 2 more than most anyone here could say. But you've had 2 interesting stories that happened on Grammy Night, in particular the first one with Brandy, where you had to save the day, so to speak. Do you remember that day? How well does that story stick with you?
Man, you talk about when I had to actually stay on the stage while she won the Grammy. Yeah, I remember the first Grammy day, of course. Like, I had gone in the night before to rehearse at the place, and at the Grammy, at the Staples Center. But the next day I got there, and I got there before everyone else did, and I was by myself, and I was like walking around the hallways, like they hadn't even opened up her band dressing room or anything, and I was just walking around the hallways by myself trying to find, you know, food or whatever. And but yeah, we got in through the day, and it was going to come up where we were up for a bunch of the main Grammys, and then the Americana ones were going to not telecast. So that thing happens before the actual telecast. Obviously, that's what they call it, the pre-telecast. But, you know, Brandy was... Basically, it was me and the band on stage, and Brandy and the twins, who were primary songwriters in her thing. And so her and them were being summoned to go over there. And she asked me, like, you want to come over and do it? And I was like, no, I'm going to stay, because if I didn't stay, it would have been just drums and the string section to kind of check for sound check. So I did, and they won during that. And so Dave Cobb was like, where's Shooter? You know, but I was on the stage, you know, I was happy to do that. It's easier for me to do that than it is to like go in there and seek attention.
But round 2, though, you got your shot of redemption the next year, though, and you got to bring someone special.
That's right. But the second year with Tanya, well, see, my daughter Bama was very upset that she couldn't come to the Grammys the first time, because it wasn't my record, and the seats scenario was so dicey, and so she was so upset. She's like, it's going to be the best night of your life. And I'm like, no, the best night of your life, my life, is the night you were born, and Blackjack, there'll be other times, you know. So she was pretty upset. She wanted to go. So the next year I basically threw a fit. It was like, I'm bringing her. I don't care if I got to pay $2,000 for these tickets that they have. You know, I'm bringing her. And so the next year we went, I got to go to the pre-telecast thing because I wasn't playing. And we won. And she won first for the song. And then it was next up was for the record, which means that I would have gotten one. And we won. And it was awesome. And my daughter was crying and was so excited. And I felt like... It ended up being such a special night between us, you know.
Now you're tied for first in your family, though, for most Grammys.
Yes, I'm tied. I'm tied with my dad for the most Grammys. So hopefully one day. I mean, the thing about it is Brandy is a Grammy magnet. So who knows if any other record I ever do won a Grammy. But if I keep any records we keep doing with Brandy, I think something about it. She's that good, you know, and they acknowledge it, and that's amazing. So I'm lucky. We'll see, you know.
She also said that you're being very humble from what she told me too. That had you not been to the stage that day, she said they were going to cancel the performance. Perhaps. Had you not been there when they called your name.
Oh, really? I didn't hear that, but I would have. I was ready to go up there. Like, well, because they were already up there for the other Grammy, and like then when they announced the record, like Bama was like, "Go!" and Misty was like, "Go!" and I was like, "I'm going."
Oh, I meant with the year before.
When
you had to go to rehearse.
Oh yeah, did she say they were gonna almost cancel the performance? I didn't know that. I heard that Brandy said they were gonna cancel the performance, but I had no idea about that. I was just doing my job, and you know, I was the only guy there that could have like strung it along because the twins had to go. You know, they had to be up there.
You had it so Stargard had quite the absolutely right band at absolutely the wrong time, but you did capture the attention of many big wigs in the LA scene at the time, including one Tom Morello. So how important has Tom been on your career, or what your career as a frontman? And you did return the favor for him in 2018, he says, too, with you being the first person to hear the Night Watchman song. So, yeah, if you could just speak to your friendship with Tom and how it kind of has gone totally full circle, where he was your producer, and you went to being his producer. On top of him being the house dad.
Tom Morello has been one of my... I mean, dearest friends and mentors and all these things for many years. Like, I met him immediately when we moved here, and he became a fan of my band, Stargun, and he used to come to all the shows, and we'd always hang out. He'd hang out at our party house. We'd go party at his parties at his house, you know, and it was, I mean, we were lunatics a little bit, but Tom got us, you know, and when we did our first record, like, well, I moved here. We've now figured out I moved here 20 years ago yesterday. And so it was, I was trying to find a date with you, but Tom was like, back then, he just was such a force of musical nature to me. And anytime you would talk to him, he'd teach you something. It was like he was recording with Rick Rubin, and he'd say stuff like, you know, he was doing Audio Slave, and he's saying like, you know, here's me and Chris and this in the band and all the years of experience between each other. And anytime we'd make, you know, an arrangement thing, Rick would change something and he'd always be right. He said he just had a sense about him. So when we started recording what was going to be our second album that never came out, that Tom produced, much of that was really him explaining arrangement things. And when you put riffs in, when you go back to the riff or you hold it till later, like choruses and bridges and what sounds good and switching them around to find the best arrangement, that kind of stuff I still think about all the time, and it definitely came from him. And I would always go and consult him about things in the music business, because he was just the automatic person, still to this day, he's like the automatic person that I would trust to have the most educated point of view from it, you know. And but he's just one of my favorite people in the world, you know, and we spent many years together. And when he was doing those Night Watchman tapes, that was like him and they'd already done the first Audio Slave record, and he was like sending them to Chris at first. And so I had this little rehearsal studio on Hollywood and Vine that we used to rehearse in, and I had a studio set up in it, so I just recorded like 20 or so of these songs of his that were awesome. And I don't even think he knew he was going to release them then, but then it became the Night Watchman project, and then he returned that favor by having me sing on one of the songs on that. And so, you know, I love Tom. I would have followed him. I still would into the hurricane, you know, because I know he's the smart one.
If he did say about you and your mother, you went to play a benefit show or some kind of Chicago, and he said, the funny story is, he said, you guys said yes. And you're like, wait, what's it for again? he said that's a testament to how you guys' relationship is that yes, then ask questions. So obviously the field's mutual.
I mean, with Tom, absolutely anything that he would ask me to do, I would do. Those were when he did those Justice, the Justice tour, and it was like, I mean, it's me and my mom and Wayne Kramer and Boots Riley and Ike Riley, who was somebody I met and became friends with and wrote one of the songs on Black Ribbons and sings on it and is, you know, I met lifelong friends there. There were some, we went to, in Chicago is where we went on May Day, we went to perform with, it was Perry Farrell and, yeah, Ben Harper was on it. It was wild. We were like out there and there was all these workers and shit. We didn't know what we were doing, but it was like, it doesn't matter because Tom's like, you know, it's always fun to be around Tom and it's always fun to do things with Tom. And he is, he's been a dear friend forever, been loyal as hell. And we have kids born on the exact same day. You know, his son Roman, my son Blackjack. It was the weirdest thing, but on the exact same day.
Which is the perfect segue into him giving you and I both shit about this, is that we both love to use Roman's town.
Yes.
Which led to, based from the Stargun years, you opened for Loaded and began a long friendship with Duff.
Yes, yeah, well, see the, yeah, man, the Loaded years, you know, the way Duff kind of came into the picture was different. This guy that we knew, Jason Teague, would throw these parties at his property down in Venice, and he would hire Stargun to play, and it'd be like, you know, 4th of July or like Memorial Day, and they would do the craziest shit. They would like, I had a little baby grand piano my parents had given me when I moved here, and it was like, we would load it into all the gigs, and I would screw on the legs, and we'd have to lift it on the stage. It was so much work. Tom used to make fun of that too. It was like so much work to look professional or whatnot. And so there was a point, like we would do these shows and he, like the Jason guy, built this huge tier that went above the fence to their property that my piano would sit on. And there was like American flag like blowing behind it. And I'm up there, this white baby grand piano playing, you know. And I remember Duff was there at that show. And he was really nice. I was so fucking, you know, starstruck by the whole thing that I felt like I couldn't believe that I was hanging out with Duff, and, you know. And then, like, over time, I kind of run into Slash here or there. And then this thing happened, and Ricky Vodka did that Club Vodka thing at the Key Club and asked us to meet. Well, initially, we were going to open for Loaded there, so we were excited about that. And then, like, a day later, I got the news that they wanted me to sing like three songs with Slash and Matt Sorum. And at the time it was a guitar player from Buck Cherry, but ended up being Dave Kushner, who was in Velvet Revolver, who has a son named Waylon, by the way. But you know, that was such a trip. And I remember I was going into the studio that day that we got that news, and it was right after my dad had died. I mean, it was probably like 2 months or 3 months after. And this homeless guy goes, "Hey man, you sing for Guns N' Roses? You look like you sing for Guns N' Roses." And I was like, in my head going, "Man, you have no idea. I just got told that I'm gonna kind of sing for Guns N' Roses, you know?" So yeah, that was when Duff kind of came in, and I would see him around. He was so nice. I mean, I was such a mess back then, man. I was drinking all the time, and, you know, 22 years old. But like, it let me get up there and sing and party. And after all these years, it kind of came back around. And I love Duff and Susan and his whole family so much. They're just such a big part of our family at this point now. You know, I've learned so many great things from him. I feel like I'm pirating because I like get to learn from all these really great people. And you know, it feels kind of like surreal, you know.
But he said he learned a lot from you in that session. He said during that, you brought out the best of him.
Well,
he didn't even know he had it in that type of genre. He said, in quotes, Americani, that I didn't think I could do it.
Well, you know, I consider that Duff record more of a rock record anyway, just because, you know, where he's coming at it is. But Americana is a good placement for a lot of things that you can't really describe what they are because they have a lot of influences mixed together. But like, you know, Duff is really excellent. And you know, the thing that we talked about Tom giving you and me shit for liking the universe, for the Use Your Illusion records. I studied those records. I thought they were brilliant masterpieces of layer upon layer of sound and vocals and things. And so when we were doing that record, you know, he knew that I loved him, but when he realized how much time I had spent with those records and how much I loved them. I think he appreciated it even more because there was a lot with those records that was very personal for him and the band and the period of time, you know. I remember arguing with Tom at the Rainbow and Nuno Bettencourt. It was Nuno Bettencourt and me and Tom, and I was saying that User Illusions were my favorite records, and they were telling me, you're fucking wrong, and I'm like, well, it's my opinion, man. I'm going to stick with it.
So, leaving Nashville to come to L.A. was, you know, it seems like these days it's the opposite of what you hear to go there, but the city of Los Angeles is a character, seemingly, on all of your writing and the music and your aesthetic. Everything, you're L.A. You're L.A. in the past 20 years. So how has the city been such an important part of shaping, A, your career, B, who you are? If you could share the story why you first came out here, what was the inspiration for it? That'd be great.
Well, I mean, okay, L.A. was all, from the time I was a kid and I saw the Muppet movie, that was the reason. Like, that in itself was, made me fall in love with L.A. And then we came here when my dad was shooting, I was a kid, and we were, he was shooting Stagecoach, that movie, that the remake they did with the Highwaymen all in it. And we were staying in a hotel and stuff, and I have like a second mom named Maureen who lived with us and raised me, and it's a big part of my life still. And I would ask her to take me into Hollywood, because to that mask shop that's down on, I would call it the mask shop, but it's the Hollywood costume place that's over on like Hollywood and Cahuenga-ish area down there. And so I would make her take me down there, you know, and I was just obsessed with it. The way that Hollywood was portrayed in the Muppet movie, I'd like sit in this hotel and you could see what was downtown Hollywood, I guess. But to me, I looked at it like that's where that place is from that movie. You know, so there was that kind of element always at play. And then as I got older, I started realizing, like, I did not want to be in Nashville. It wasn't my speed. It wasn't where I was interested in a lot of other things. I was very interested in computers. The big city made sense to me. And so I remember feeling like it was like New York or L.A. And I wasn't interested in going to New York. Like, we visited L.A. and instantly I saw the palm trees and the weather, and I hated the cold, I hated the humidity down there. Like, it just instantly, pretty girls, it instantly, like, it looked like paradise, you know. But then when I got here, I still to this day, after 20 years, I have this feeling like, I can't believe I live here. It still is that way with me. And there's so much history here, and that I love seeing when the guy paints the big Charles Bukowski on the side of the Mint. Like, I'm like, I love this town. Like, it just, there's something about it. It's magic, and it's like around every corner. It's art and entertainment, and like, it's a melting pot of like kind of histories. People who wanted to come here and be somebody else, I guess, in a way. It's not that I wanted to be somebody else. I loved who I was, but you got to come here and you got to kind of make it up as you went. And that to me was really appealing. And I was 21 years old, you know, and I was like, I'm ready to go. My dad had cousins live out here we'd visit too, and it just made a lot of sense. And I love it, and I've known, because I stayed here so long, is why I have a lot of things that have been good in my life happened to me, you know, whether it be from my kids to working with Duff and Tom to Manson to, like, you know, it's because I stuck it out here and I believed in it here. Like, I didn't keep chasing what was cool, you know. It was never cool to come here since I moved here, but it's like at the same time, it's the coolest place in the world to me.
Gaming. People don't realize that you're quite an avid gamer.
That's right.
You're quite good at it too, so how did that come about? And you still do it to this day, so too.
Yeah, when I was a little kid, video games, I loved. Well, I had a Nintendo, and I remember feeling like it was the most magical thing that I'd ever seen, like when I was playing Metroid and Zelda and all these games like that. And then, like, we got a computer really early on, and I remember really feeling like this is the most creative tool I could possibly use. Like, you could do anything with a computer. Like, you could make your own game, or you could make movies, or you could make music. And as it went on, I used it for all of the above, you know. And there was, like, I make these games now. I used to run a bulletin board system. I still run it, and it's like I make games for them now. And my son and I play all kinds of video games together. We have VR in the house, and I still play all the old Nintendo games on our bus and old arcade games. I collect them. It's, you know, I'm very much someone rooted in my childhood, and it serves me, it makes me happy to no end to continue to live in it in a way. You know what I mean?